It's the state's third most populated city. Allentown is home to more than 100,000 people. Settled by Germans in the 18th century, fueled by the iron needs of a growing railroad industry in the 19th century, and producing everything from silk to cigars in the 20th century, Allentown is amidst another transition. So who's the best man to lead the city here in the 21st century? We talk with current Mayor Ed Pawlowski and his challenger, City Councilman Tony Phillips, right now on Tempo Public Square.
Support for Tempo Public Square is provided by the members of PBS 39.
Like many of our region's cities, it's a time of transition for Allentown, a transition from a manufacturing base into a more service-based economy. So what can be done with all those existing but empty manufacturing structures? What can be done about crime? What can be done about taxes in this sluggish economy? These issues face folks in Allentown, and maybe you in your town too. And they are top of mind for two men fighting to hold the top job in the city. That is, of course, the job of Allentown's mayor. And Election Day is November 3rd. Right now, I do welcome to the studio Allentown's Democrat and incumbent mayor, Ed Pawlowski. Ed, thanks for joining us today.
Thank you. Thanks for having us.
And to your left is your challenger, Tony Phillips, ex-cop city councilman. Thanks so much for being here, Tony.
And I, too, thank you for having both of us so we can express our ideas.
Well, it's great for all of us to learn and hear your sides and help the viewers make their decision. So first, though, gentlemen, some rules for the road. We are going to have two 12-minute segments to talk. We'll start out with a chance for you both to have some opening remarks, about 30-second opening remarks. Then it'll be some questions where I'd love to have you answer within a minute with rebuttal. If you weren't the first person to get the question, of course, you'll have time for rebuttal. And then we'll wrap it up with 30-second closing remarks. All righty? And in deference to you, Mayor, as the incumbent, I will start with you with opening remarks. Why should folks out there put you in office or keep you in office, rather?
Well, I mean, when I came into office basically 4 years ago, we faced a very difficult climb up a very steep hill. We were faced with some daunting challenges. We had a budget that had an $8 million deficit, a gap. We had a police force that was decimated by early retirements. Crime was on the rise. The perception of Allentown, and quite honestly, the future of our city looked bleak. 4 years later, I think we've come a lot farther and faster than anybody thought possible. We've rebalanced our budgets, created huge reserves and surpluses to make it through this very difficult economic time, rebuilt our police force, improved the quality of life. We still have a long way to go, but Allentown is going to be a great city again.
All right. Thank you, Mayor. And now, Tony Phillips, for your opening remarks. Why should folks vote for you?
I'm running for mayor because I want to return the city back to its historical, cultural, and traditional values. I think that we need to impact our crime, to actually fix our budget, and to make our neighborhoods great again. I think I can do that because of my history of 26 years of service to bring to the table, experience as a former police officer, as a community volunteer, and the things that I've been involved in this community. So I think that's one of the reasons why I think they should consider me.
All right, Tony, I will start questioning with you. And you did mention this in your opening remarks. You were a cop for 21 years before you retired. And you do have some, you know, obviously a lot of experience on the streets. As mayor, though, how would you tackle crime in Allentown?
Well, thank you for asking. I would certainly start by looking at reorganizing our police department and putting in some more, adding some additional units to the police department, starting with the anti-crime unit, which would go out and sweep the hot areas or the really high crime areas in our city. From there, then I would also then move on to re-implement the neighborhood community policing program, which would put a police officer in the community to do problem solving and interacting with the community and become interrelated with the city and the community. So those are some of the things some places where we start. It certainly has been a drastic impact when we implemented that program in 1990, which I was actually part of the implementation. So I think those are some of the things that we would initially start out doing.
All right. And Mayor, fighting crime in Allentown?
You know, when I came into office 4 years ago, crime was at an all-time high. The police force, due to unprecedented wave of retirements, was really decimated. We lost about a third of our entire police force. 4 years later, we have rebuilt that police force. We've hired over 70 new officers. We worked with the best experts in the country, George Kelling and Bob Wasserman, to form a community policing strategy out of Rutgers University. Actually wrote the book called Broken Windows Theory on Community Policing. Helped Giuliani restructure the police force. We've restructured our districts. We put more police on the streets. We've put new technologies in our cameras. We made our streets unsafe for criminals to operate and unfriendly for criminals to operate. And we have seen crime decrease by over 20% in the last 4 years. We're going to continue to improve and rebuild our police force, hiring more officers and making sure that Allentown is a safe place for people to live, work, and play.
And a follow-up for that, what is the cost? How much more money did you have to put into crime in your last 4 years?
It's been tremendous. I mean, each officer cost about $100,000. Mm-hmm. We've built up and hired over 70 new officers. We actually have more officers now than when I came in. When I came in 2006, we had 196 officers in the budget. We now have over 203. We had 151 patrol officers. We now have over 171. That's over 20 officers. We've rebuilt our detective division. That's taken time. We had basically 14 when I came in 2006. We're up to 12. Our vice, we had 10. We're now up to 10 vice officers. We've been making impacts on crime. We just did sweeps this summer. Over 64 individuals were arrested. We've taken down major gang operations working with the state police and the FBI and the DEA. We've been collaborating with other cities for this first time. We're making some real impacts and inroads into crime and reducing crime within our neighborhoods.
All right, thank you. And Tony, you have some things to say about that, I think.
I certainly disagree. And disagree in the fact that we have not increased the number of police officers on the police department. 80 police officers retired. We replaced 80. We're still at the same number. We're actually not even at the same number. We're less than when the mayor came into office. We're at 203, as he indicates. We started at 216. So that's a problem for me, is when you start talking about the numbers. When you start talking about crime, crime is up. You know, crime is certainly up. You know, when you talk about personal crime, crime against people, it's up 3.5%. Pervasively overall, maybe crime is down, but the crimes that concern the individuals, the citizens of Allentown, are the personal crimes. When you talk about crime is down 20%, well, you know, it's been 20, it's been 14, it's been 23. What is the real number? The real number is it's up 3.5%. When you talk about innovation, certainly there's innovation that's been implemented, but the innovation that's moved crime to other parts of the city. You know, other cities have seen parts of the city have seen increase in crime. Certainly is not an indication that things have changed. And when you talk about real technology for police officers, why don't officers have tasers? That's something that's more important, that would be a direct impact into what the officers do every day. The cameras only move it away. Officers are still running from call to call. They're not doing proactive things. And we speak about Mr. Wasserman, Mr. Kelton, that's really a great a talking point. But when you talk about real community policing and putting people out into the community, what Mr. Wasserman and Mr. Kelton wants us to do is to walk, park, and walk. Officers don't even interact with the community. I've watched them. I've seen them. And the community's also responded with that. And another point is to this is that the mayor has said that we've increased our investigation quite the contrary. It's being decimated as well. The Kellen plan wants us to have no investigators and want the police officers on the street to do the investigations from the beginning to the end.
Right. It's not. Tony, I'm going to have to let the mayor rebut.
I don't know where he's getting his statistics. I don't know where he's getting his information, but it's not true. If you look at the FBI and state police statistics, you will see, you know, for decades, crime was going up in the city. For the last 4 years, crime has been going down in part one and two crimes, over 20% in the last 4 years. We have made a tremendous impact in reducing the amount of call volume. We looked at all the calls that we had. We reduced our call volume tremendously so that they don't have to respond. One of the things that we were responding to was ambulance assist calls. We shifted that responsibility to the fire department. They are responding to ambulance assist calls, freed up 20,000 hours of time for our police to be more proactive instead of just being reactive within the community. We've increased walking patrols up over 400% just from last year alone. Business checks are up over 200% from last year alone. These are just facts. We've actually, you know, Tony talks about rebuilding the police department, we have hired more officers. When I came in, he needs to look at his budget book, because it was 196 in 2006. It's 203 now. It's actually 215 in the budget. We still have more to go. We still have more to hire. But Tony has voted against many times, consistently, voting against hiring new officers. And so, you know, he talks about that he wants to increase the police force, but he's actually voted against hiring new officers. So we have made
Again, there's another distortion, because here's the official voting record. It comes out of city clerk's office, and the mayor, again, I don't know where he got his records from.
I got my records out of the clerk's office.
The gentleman will have to agree to disagree, because
Tony Phillips voted against. 2007, Tony Phillips voted against. My point is this. We have rebuilt our police department. We've used new technology. Those technology
distorted.
Please.
Well, and gentlemen, you know what? It is about crime. It is about numbers. And voters can find these things on your website.
Absolutely. And they can find the things by looking at the city's website as well.
Okay.
But, you know, we've used new technology. I'm very proud of the cameras. We have over 80 cameras up now in the city. They've actually been very effective, over 20% reduction every time we put up a camera. Solved two homicides as a result of it. In the morning call yesterday, there was an article about an individual that was arraigned in court. He was actually caught on camera committing a homicide. And that camera helped to convict that individual. So we have used this technology. It's been very effective, and it has reduced crime within the city.
And we're going to move on to quality of life, because it is all about, I mean, the crime and the stats and the safety is about quality of life. And there are some great things going on in Allentown. We have Iron Pig Stadium, where my family attends, at Coca-Cola Park all the time, and the Symphony Center and the Art Museum. Tony, how would you improve, and we are running out of time in this segment, improve quality of life on those bigger issues like that, outside of the crime situation?
Those things are all nice for photo ops. Those are all nice for glossies. But what the real quality of life is, the everyday things that are in your neighborhood, the things that bother you most. The community complains about the things that bother them when they're sitting in their home. That's quality of life, not the glossy, not the fluff. We have to deal with those issues directly. And as again, I say, you have to be a direct correlation between City Hall, the police, and the community. And how will we do that? I think it's the only way we're going to impact our crime. Because if you look at City of Allentown, it tells us it's a cleaner city. It's not. When you talk about issues about quality of life and the things that bother people, the noise, the music, those things are still happening. So it's wonderful.
Okay, and Mayor, quality of life.
You know what? We've addressed quality of life issues head on. We've actually created new programs to clean up our streets. We partnered with the Allentown Rescue Mission and started a program called the Clean Team. We actually have formerly homeless individuals helping to clean our streets. We've gone after illegal landlords. We've targeted graffiti vandals, and we've reduced graffiti crimes dramatically within the city. We've gone after problem landlords, and we've gone after nuisance crimes. Tony talks about loud music. Yes, it's a real problem within the community. Everybody thinks it's a problem. When I go to community groups, so one thing they talked about, we actually made our sweep tickets so that officers can give out now tickets for loud music. Tony voted against that. He was the only one who actually voted against that particular ordinance. And so we have been actually working on improving quality of life in our neighborhood. There's still a lot that needs to be done, a lot that needs to be accomplished, but we're making some significant strides.
Gentlemen, lots more to talk about. We have another 12-minute segment, so sit tight. We'll be right back with you. But we're going to talk about property taxes, small business growth, and larger economic development. And what about that budget? We'll talk more with the mayor of Allentown and his challenger as the November 3rd election day approaches. That's all just ahead right here on Tempo Public Square. Welcome back, everybody, to Tempo Public Square. We're talking with two gentlemen who are vying for the top leadership spot in the city of Allentown. That is, of course, Mayor Ed Pawlowski, a Democrat. The incumbent is here joining us, and challenger Republican Tony Phillips, former cop and city councilman for the city of Allentown. Thanks so much for joining us. And now, we were talking about crime and quality of life. Gentlemen, our conversation will continue now with economic development and taxes and the budget. Lots to cover. And Ed, I will start with you. You have some history and experience with the economic development situation. You used to run that department for the city of Allentown back in your days in Chicago, dealing with urban issues and housing issues. issues. What is your economic development philosophy now and in the next?
Well, you know, when I came in 4 years ago, you know, I was community economic development director for several years. We saw some development starting to happen and occur in the city of Allentown for the first time in many years. I had left, and it basically came to a standstill. When I came in, we re-energized that engine, and we've seen a wave of development that has really affected, I think, every part of the city. You talked about the Iron Pigs. 620,000 people visited last year, came into our city as a result of that. The old Hanover Acres, which was one of the most crime-ridden places in the city, we rebuilt it, an $82 million mixed-use, mixed-income development, really transformed that neighborhood, reduced crime in that particular area. On the south side, we rebuilt, we built new industrial incubators with the help of our economic development agency, 100,000 square foot industrial incubator, 5 new companies, 150 new jobs in our city. The old Exide plant, which eluded development for 30 years, is now cleaned up. It was a former Brownfield Superfund site, $20 million development on that site. Downtown, we have 5 new restaurants that opened up in the last several months, $120 million in new development. Good things are happening all over the city, and we're going to continue that progress. My goal is to make Allentown a place that people could be proud of again, make it that economic center. It's the third largest city in the state. It employs the most people in this entire region. 60,000 people work in the city every day. It has driven the force of this economy in this entire region for many years. It'll drive the force of this economy for many years to come.
All right, Tony, economic development, big business. What's your take?
It's great business, but the nice part about what my opponent said is the development, again, is great. But we're the real jobs. The real jobs, and that's where you drive your economic development. You have to have jobs that are real jobs that are reaching out to the people that are from Allentown. We have 60,000 people working in Allentown, but they travel in and out. They're not Allentonians, and I think that's where the point's being missing, that we are still a deprived, depressed community. Whether we have all the development, all the shiny buildings, until people can work, that drives the business of home ownership, of job, disposable money, and that's where we need to be driven to, and that's where our economic should be focused on.
Well, so Tony, you're talking about real jobs. Do you mean more small business rather than the big business? Explain.
Without a doubt, small business drives is the backbone of this country. So if you have a more Allentown as a base that are more manual labor people, it's our biggest base of residents, that's what their job specifications and qualifications are. That's where we should be reaching to. That's where we should be bringing small business in to set up manufacturing, to do more development in some of these buildings, like the Phoenix Forge, the Phoenix Clothing Place at 3rd and Hamilton. We should be doing more of those kind of things that people can walk to these jobs instead of have to travel outside the city to do other jobs in our industrial parks.
Well, as mayor, this brings me to my next question, and we can jump in also. Well, you can jump in as well, Ed. But we're talking about, I think of the property taxes and this tough economic time that we're in and high cost of health insurance and how does a small businessman, if you become mayor, Tony, how are you going to help the small businessman deal with those rising costs in a dwindling economy?
Well, there's several ways to do that. The first way I talk about it is you start looking at the business privilege tax. Today we tax them on their gross instead of their net. When you can take that individual business and he's making $1,000 but his overhead's $900 and you tax him as well as you tax another business who's making another $1,000 but his overhead is only $500, half of that. The guy who has a lesser overhead is actually getting unfairly taxed. You have to level out the taxing. And I guess when you talk about gross and you talk about net, it's something that people don't really don't grasp, but it is about how much difference you have in your expenditures at the end of the day.
My
opponent said a lot of things, so let me correct some of the misinformation. First off, I think there's a lot of people that have gotten jobs. There's a lot of people, as you know, that work at Coca-Cola Park. In fact, my neighbor down the block works at Coca-Cola Park. A lot of people have gotten jobs through the things that we have developed in this economy. A lot of people work at the new $150 million facility that St. Luke's has built off of Hamilton Street. There's a lot of community jobs that have been developed. We have a program called Weed and Seed. Part of that program is to root out crime within a particular area, but also bring in new economic development and revitalization. That program, we've had a job counselor has been working with the lowest income individuals that we have. Over 300 people have now gotten full-time jobs with benefits as a result of that particular program. We have a Main Street program on 7th Street focusing on small business, helping to attract new small businesses. 21 new small businesses have come into 7th Street, have gotten facade loans, help with microenterprise loans to start their small businesses. We have a new Main Street program that we're working on with the Chamber to develop on Hamilton Street. We have a new citywide business loan program that we're developing, and we're working with the stimulus money that we're getting from the federal government to provide low-interest loans for energy efficiency to reduce the costs for businesses to operate within the community. We're doing a lot to attract businesses. My goal for the next 4 years is to really focus in on creating a green economy. We have to transform from this old industrial base that we had into a new economy and a new industrial base. We have to create more jobs for working class people, and we're doing that. We've developed some incubators, like I said. We've attracted 5 new companies. We're going to develop more green incubators. We're looking for ways to attract those green economy jobs. People that make solar panels, people that make those wind farms. Those are the jobs of the future. Those are the jobs that we are focused on. In fact, we were just chosen is one of 3 cities in the state, along with states with 3 cities like Youngstown in Ohio, states in Michigan and South Carolina, to basically, through the German Marshall Fund, to go to Germany. In fact, our community economic development director is going, because I can't go this week because it's a week before the election, but she's going to Germany to actually look at how they have transformed their industrial-based economies to more green economies.
All right.
We're
going
to do that here in Allentown. That's the way of the future, and we are going to continue to grow our economy and make Allentown a leader in this industry.
Gentlemen, let's move on to the budget. It's balanced. You got it balanced. But it is an $80 million budget. 30 million of it is property tax.
Mm-hmm.
And revenue streams across government avenues are dwindling, and it's going to be a challenge in the next administration to balance that budget again. Tax hikes, what are you going to do about that, Tony? What's going to happen?
Well, let's start off by saying I don't know where you got the information that the budget's balanced. It has not been balanced, and we're at a deficit this year. If you want to talk about the numbers, they're truly out there, and it's been chronicled by our own controller. It's been chronicled by our CAFR, which is Comprehensive Financial Report, and by our auditor. How you deal with this? And how you deal with it in the future. We have to make sure that we, as a government, can minimize and control our spending. We can't overestimate our revenues. We have to be true and honest and transparent on our revenues and in our expenditures. And that's what's not been happening. So those are the kind of things you have to control. You have to do some internal controls on those things.
And Tony, to follow up for our viewers, you say the budget is not balanced because I suspect you're discussing the loan that Ed took out for the city to help make ends meet.
That's not even part of that, of what I'm discussing. I'm talking about the numbers. You know, our CAFR says that we're $5.9 million shortfall for this year. That came out of 2008. So we also have another $3 million that we're going to have a shortfall, a little less than $3 million shortfall, by our own auditor for this year, for 2009. So we have a $9.7 million shortfall that is not in addition to the loan.
You probably got the balanced budget from looking at the budget book, because it is balanced. We actually, you know, this has been a tough 4 years. We inherited a very difficult situation. I had a budget that was given to me when I came into office, supposed to have an $800,000 surplus. They actually had an $8 million deficit. We took that deficit. We created a $9 million surplus. We took out a loan that you talked about to actually shore up our risk management fund and make sure we had reserves. This is something that Standard & Poor's and Moody's both advised us to do. And that actually improved our bond rating. We went from a triple B minus to a triple B plus. Our financial outlook went from negative to positive by both by Standard & Poor's and Moody's. We have moved the city in a very positive direction and a much stronger fiscal footing. Now, we had some challenges. Like every municipality across the state of Pennsylvania, like every corporation, we have seen a decrease in our revenue this year. The good news is we built up a huge cash reserve over the course of the last several years by cutting the cost of government, using taxpayer money wisely, looking for new forms of revenue, and we've built up this huge cash reserves, just like Joseph. So we had we built it up in times of plenty, so we have it in times of need. And we have done a very good job, I think, in managing the taxpayers' money wisely. Now, you know, for the last 4 years, we haven't had to raise taxes. This year, we're not going to have to raise taxes. We have the lowest amount of staff than we've had in probably in the last 20 years in city government. We're lean, we're mean. We're continuously looking for ways to cut costs and use taxpayer dollars wisely. And it's going to be tough. economy's going to be tough.
It's going to be tough. You might have to raise taxes, though, if you're elected again.
What? We're going to look for everybody. Listen, everybody said we had to raise taxes when I was elected 4 years ago, and we had this $8 million deficit, okay? Mm-hmm. We built up a $9 million surplus. That's pretty darn good over the course of the last 4 years. We did that by cutting costs year after year, beating our budget projections, looking for new forms of revenue. You know, we were the Bethlehem and Allentown, the only two cities in the entire Commonwealth of Pennsylvania that actually worked out a revenue sharing agreement for casino revenues. We actually wrote that into the final gaming law. We get 20% of their revenues for perpetuity. This year alone, we're getting about $800,000. Next year, we're going to get close to $4 million in revenue. You know, this is new revenue that is not put on the taxpayer. And so we've been looking for new revenue sources. We've been cutting costs. We've been restructuring our debts. And we actually restructured our debt when we got that higher bond rating, saved $19 million for the taxpayers over the next 7 years.
All right, thank you. Thank you, because now we've got to wrap up for closing comments. And I know you have something to say about what he just said and then some closing comments, Tony.
No, that was a nice stump speech and it went really well. But when you look at the real numbers, it's all documented.
Well, voters are going to have to do that. They're going to go on websites and check that out.
Thank you.
So, Tony, why should everyone out there voting on November 3rd make a change in the administration in the city of Allentown, Pennsylvania, third largest city in the state? I mean, this is you've got to control. A big, large area to control. What's up, Tony?
It's real simple. We want to return the government back to the folks that pay for the government. We want to make sure it's simple government so that it's simple to follow, go down a ledger, go down our legislation, go down the road to be able to simply understand exactly what the government's doing for them. It's real simple. I know that as a law enforcement, I can bring law and order back to the city of Allentown. I can reduce crime. And I know that I can change it street by street, house by house, street by street, block by block, and community by community. I know that I can direct this in the right way. Once you reduce crime, you can raise investment.
All right. Thank you, Tony. Ed?
You know, when I came into office 4 years ago, Allentown was at a crossroads. Our bond rating and our fiscal outlook was negative. We had little investment. Police force was decimated due to early retirements. The outlook for the city was bleak. 4 years later, it's a much different picture. We've actually improved our fiscal condition. We've brought new investment in jobs and development into our city, rebuilt our police force, used new technologies, reduced crime throughout our communities, and attacked quality of life issues. We still have a long way to go. There's a lot of stuff that needs to be accomplished. We've made a lot of progress in the last 4 years. If you vote for me on November 3rd, I'm going to continue to work hard to bring new jobs and investment, new technologies into our city. I'm going to continue to rebuild our police force and reduce crime. I'm going to continue to rebuild our neighborhoods. So thank you very much. Please vote for me on November 3rd. It's a great city. It's going to be even a better city in the next 4 years to come.
Ed Pulaski, incumbent Democrat mayor of Allentown, and challenger Tony Phillips, sex cop and city councilman. November 3rd is the date. The date for you both, the meeting in the polls. And a reminder to all you voters that it is November 3rd, and you do have a chance to make your voice heard for your choice of Allentown mayor. Some district judgeships are out there, some city and county council spots. Make sure you do get to the polls. And, of course, be sure to email me with your comments and ideas at Public Square right here at publicsquare@wlvt.org. You can also go online at wlvt.org and watch any of these shows online. Next time on Tempo Public Square, we drink in the debate over a regional water consolidation plan. So grab a glass of water and join me next time right here on Tempo Public Square.
Support for Tempo Public Square is provided by the members of PBS 39.